Today on the DML News podcast, there are crazy videos all over X, all over the internet, of liberals going absolutely bonkers because Trump won an election. They're doing crazy things. They're saying things that are obscene. And we're going to analyze it today from a medical perspective with Dr. Nick Kardashian. So get ready because it's all unfiltered.
Dennis Michael Lynch gives you his word, and he will never let you down. He will always fight for America.
The only one who really puts his money where his mouth is Dennis Michael Lynch.
Hello, I'm Dennis Michael Lynch, and I thank you for joining me today. So Donald Trump, as you know, won the election. Great thing, great time. America is going to be great again. But for some people, they think it's the worst thing that could have ever happened. And on my X account, which you can follow me, by the way, that's x.com/trustDML is my handle, trustDML. I have been over and over again sharing videos that are just so unbelievable. Some of them are coming from the mainstream media. Some of them are coming from young whites. Some of them are coming from minorities. But overall, they are all disturbing. I am going to play a couple for you here. I'm just going to chain them together. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring in Dr. Nick. Dr. Nick has been a friend of mine now for going on almost 10 years. He is a therapist. He works with alcoholism, addiction, and mental health problems. So he is the right person to bring in for this conversation. Let's just listen right now to some of these videos.
Not sure why no one understands how I feel. You guys know that my husband turned Republican this term. I don't know why. I threw his ass out of the house. And I have to do more. I don't want to shave my head because that's going to hurt him. I'm going to look ugly. So I'm not doing that. I think I'm going to sleep with his friends. I think that's the only way. I think sleeping with his friends will do. What do you guys think? His liberal friends, of course.
If you're queer and your family voted for Trump like mine did, hi, hello, I'm your mother now. Just checking in, have you drank water today? Did you eat? Did you take your meds? Did you breathe? Are you breathing? You gotta breathe in your belly, babe. Let's take a breath together, okay? Ready? Inhale through the nose. Hold. Exhale through the mouth. Let your breath ground you. You are alive, babes, and I love you so much.
Well, it's happening. The family wants to know what I'm doing for the holidays. I'm going to be here with my dogs and my daughter, who is of childbearing age and now has to get an IUD at 17 years old. And I'm going to be here with my son, who is a political target. And that should really tell you all you need to know about why I'm not going to be hanging out with y'all for the holidays. So fuck off. Choke on your turkey. Bye.
All right. Before I bring in Dr. Nick, let me just explain to you real quick. DML CBD. If Kamala Harris would have won, BOGOs were gone forever. Just wouldn't have been able to do it. Trump has won. We're very low on inventory. I was preparing for the worst and hoping for the best. The best happened, but we still are in a very, very, very dark economy where it's going to take a long time, at least 6 months, to get back to normal. The last BOGO, site-wide BOGO, that we will have for this year and probably for the first couple of months going into 2025 is happening now. I'm ending it this Sunday coming. So please, if you're an existing customer, dmlcbd.com/BOGO, load up, because when you come back to me and say, DML, I need some stuff, I'm not going to have anything for you on a BOGO. If you aren't an existing customer, man, you are really missing out. If you have sleep issues, if you have skin issues, if you want to boost your immune system, especially with the winter months coming, if you have aches and pains, and of course, listen, anxiety. DML CBD has been a lifesaver for tens of thousands of people. My stepfather couldn't sleep for years. Now using DML CBD, sleeps through the night like a baby. My wife had eczema all over herself. It was horrible. She would scrape it off with a knife. She now uses our oils and our topicals. It's all gone. Had another guy the other day. We were at a Christmas party. We did a grab bag, and I put a bottle of 6.7 Miracle Me in there. And he wound up, you know, it was one of those, you trade the gifts. He wouldn't even trade up. He said, that's it. I'm keeping this. That's that. So immune system, you know, people who have said, hey, I've been on your DML CBD. I never got COVID. I haven't been sick, whatever. So many different testimonials. Go check it out, dmlcbd.com. The BOGO means that whatever you buy, we double your order. You buy one, you get two. You buy three, you get six. You buy 10, you get 20. It's great. It lowers the price hugely. Go in and take a look at it. Don't miss this opportunity. It's a great time for you to get in. All right. Now, with that being said, Dr. Nick is going to join us. We're going to talk about what's happening with all these videos, why the meltdown is happening on the left, and it is happening at extremes. There's one video. I'll show it to you right now real quick before we bring him in. There is a family that is actually moving to Canada because Trump won. So they're moving from a free country to a socialist nation. But is what it is. Socialized medicine over there. Wait until they get sick and sit in the hospital for 8 hours. But we wish nothing bad on anybody. Let me now bring in Dr. Nick and show you some more of the videos that need to be seen. Nick, as always, it's great to see you, pal. The last time we were together, I can't remember what we were talking about, but it definitely wasn't videos of people losing their brains because of Donald Trump winning an election.
No, it wasn't. Something else was happening that might have been unstable in the air, but it wasn't that. But good to be on the show again, Dennis. Thank you.
Well, it's always, I always get great response from people when you're on. So what I wanted to do today, and you and I sort of spoke about this before we started getting going here, was I picked out a series of videos. And I think the videos all come, well, they're all wrapped around one thing. These are people who, from a funny standpoint, have Trump derangement syndrome at a level that I didn't even know existed. But I want to get more into the serious side. I mean, we could joke around, you and I. We've done that plenty of times before. But I'd like to really get to the serious part of this, because I've been saying something for the past year. And when I first started saying it, my audience thought I was kidding. And I'm not. It may sound a little out there, but when you look up the charts, Doc, you'll see that heart disease and cancer are always number one and two in terms of what it is that they say are the biggest health crises in the country. I don't believe that's true. Not anymore anyway. I believe mental health is the number one problem we have in the country. But the problem being is that, you know, because you don't grab your chest or you don't take a statin, nobody is, or you don't shave your, well, I shouldn't say you shouldn't shave your head because we're going to get to videos where people are shaving their head, but because you don't lose your hair, people don't see it as much, or they tuck it under the rug, maybe because they're mentally ill themselves. So I think the number one thing is mental illness. And when you look at the reaction to what people are giving towards Donald J. Trump winning the election, even though his first 4 years proved out to be nothing even close to what everybody warned and feared the first time and have absolutely no reason to believe it's going to be any different the second time, they have gone down an absolute road to proving my fact that until we do autopsies on a whole bunch of Democrats, no matter what their age, no matter what their color, race, gender, you name it, we're never going to find out what really is firing or misfiring in that brain. There's got to be a misfire, doctor. And I know you don't like to play the political spectrum or whatever it may be, but we don't see people on the right doing these maniac sort of things that they're doing on the left. And do you concur with that? Am I totally out of my mind? Do you think there is maybe something misfiring in these politically crooked people?
Well, I do think... Well, so I agree with you that there's a mental health crisis happening both in our country and throughout the world. And there, you know, I think if you kind of back up and take a more of a 30,000 foot view, we're more mentally unwell as a society to begin with. We have record rates of depression, anxiety, suicide, overdose, ADHD. So we're more unwell to begin with. And I have some theories about why that is. So we're more vulnerable towards, let's call it ideological brainwashing, emotional reactivity, this highly intensive responses that we're seeing, which are symptomatic of certain kinds of mental illness, personality disorders, borderline personality disorder. There are certain mental disorders that are symptomatic of, so for example, borderline personality disorder is typified by black and white thinking, hyper emotional reactivity, really intense, highly suicidal, highly erratic. And so we're seeing more of that personality type. And, you know, one of my theories is that this is a social media driven digital landscape virus that has spread, because what, irregardless of the content on social media, so think about what social media is and the new digital world that we've been living in for 5 to 10 years now. It's an extremification loop of black and white content. There's no nuance. There's no civil discourse, because that doesn't get the views on social media. So you have, we're priming people's minds to really only see things in really extreme versions of things. And so if you're priming somebody to be so ideologically black and white, that echo chamber, that intensification begins to be how they process information. So now you've created a person that's been so brainwashed that they can only see things on emotional extremes, because they've been living on this emotional extreme. It's a good way that I could put it, Dennis. It's like when, if I'm going to analogize it to like violence and aggression with media content, right? If back in the day, they used to say that if we watched violent cartoons, we would get desensitized to violence and we would become more violent. So if we watched, you know, Bugs Bunny or Wile E. Coyote, they used to think that that would make us more violent, right? And then now we notice the content got increasingly more realistic and more violent. We started seeing more aggressive and more violent people. So Grand Theft Auto video games made these adolescents much more violent than Bugs Bunny ever made you and I. And you get desensitized and numb to it. So then you start needing increasingly more violent content to get the same reaction. So now you develop this desensitized effect. So I think that's happened in our political world as well. We've become numb to normal political discourse, and now we need the fascist language, the Hitler language, because that's what gets the emotional reaction, because the emotional reaction is king now. Everything's about the emotional reaction, because that drives engagement. So, you know, it's funny, because just a couple of days ago, I was watching the Reagan-Mondale debate, right, where he has a great line about, you know, I'm not going to let my opponent's age be an issue. Yeah. And here are two guys that were on the opposite ends of the political aisle, right? You know, you had Reagan, the Reagan movement, and you had Walter Mondale, you know, boring Minnesota senator.
Yeah.
And there was such civil discourse between the two of them. They weren't throwing political verbal grenades at each other. They weren't calling each other Hitler and fascist. There was opposing views, but we hadn't created this social virus, this climate where people were so emotionally unstable, have been made so emotionally unstable by all this extreme content that they're swimming in. So now, of course, we've got this the situation where we've made people unwell. Politics has become the new religion. It's the new ideology, because all people's happiness eggs are put in that basket now, because for a lot of people, they've identified so wholly because they don't have balance in their lives now. That's the other piece of the puzzle. Historically, we used to have family, community supports, different things that we identified with. You know, you were a member of the Rotary Club or the Scouts or a basketball team that gave you a sense of perspective and balance. Now people are either all in on the new religion, and if you are if you violate any of the doctrine, you're going to get this intense attack on a person's entire identity, because their entire identity is defined by this new ideology. So it's an existential threat to say, you know, Trump is in office, and you know we see some of the hysterical responses.
The thing about this, though, and I think it goes deeper, maybe, because if Trump really was a Hitler, let's assume for the moment that he had killed, I don't know, 20 people. Let's just say that Trump was a general who now is, you know, moved over to the political side of things and is running and has a history of, hey, you know, what about back in 1987 when you led people into Nicaragua and you killed those 20 innocent people? They don't even have something like that to go off. Everything that Trump has done to date has been good for all people. I mean, he hasn't done anything that resembles Hitler. He hasn't done anything that resembles being a communist or a dictator. And yet the mainstream media is funneling and pushing this. And so somebody like me, and I assume somebody like yourself, again, I'm not trying to drag you into the political landscape here, but you know, I read that and I say, okay, or I hear it and I say, seriously, you're going to call him Hitler? Hitler put 6 million people in an oven and turned it on. This person put more money into 6 million people's more money. Where are you getting this from? And I say to myself, what kind of mind accepts that as being true? Right. And then to the point of where they're going to go online and regurgitate it. So these people truly have to have some kind of mental problems. Yes.
Well, yes. I mean, I'm not denying that there is a mental unwellness, there are mental illness, whatever you want to call it. But look at where they got it from. Because, you know, I was really struck by how this was happening, how this media narrative was happening. Okay, let's look at dictator for a day, or he was going to shoot, or he was fantasizing. I kept hearing he was fantasizing about shooting Liz Cheney in the face, right? And that got over and over and over again in the brainwashing echo chamber of all of it, MSNBC, the whole social media. And then when you looked at the actual quotes and the context, right, we looked at the dictator for a day. Sean Hannity asked him, hey, what are you going to do day one? And he jokingly was laughing and said, because the narrative was, he's told us he's going to be a dictator from day one. He said, only on day one, I'm going to be a dictator because I'm going to shut the border down. And he started laughing. So contextually, it was a joke, which they ran with. I mean, I heard the dictator for a day, which was based on that one throwaway comment repeated over and over again. So think about the brainwashing. Now, you're already trying to make the case that this guy's an authoritarian. So that got drumbeated in. The Liz Cheney quote, I think, was even worse. He's trying to actually defend and be a peacenik. He's actually saying these are warmongers that are sending our kids into battle. And he's saying Liz Cheney's never had to face the fog of war or the horrors of battle. And she's never had to face gunfire. And that got twisted and amplified as he's fantasizing about shooting her in the face. And no one pushed back on that. So if you're some 19-year-old, depressive, vulnerable person who gets all your content from the same echo chambers, it's shoot Liz Cheney in the face. Dictator for a day. And then, you know, and then there was, you know, 10, 15 more of those examples. So that's all you're hearing. And it's interesting because I watched Bill Maher the other night and he had on the left-wing guest who mentioned the same thing about shooting Liz Cheney in the face. And Bill Maher for a moment said, well, that's not true. But then they brushed right over it because then they went on to something else. And to some degree, I kind of almost blame Trump. I mean, I didn't hear him vociferously say, hey, that's not what I said, because I wish that somebody would have just clarified it, just said, these are quotes that are being used. And then, you know, of course, you've got the felon, because, you know, we had some of the, on the right that were now calling them all these names and, you know, rapists and felons. When, of course, we know that Bill Clinton had been, you know, credibly charged with rape and all sorts of other offenses, and that didn't seem to bother those folks. But it was a different political climate. It was a different digital media climate. These people are unwell. Their lives are out of balance. They're suffering from, I think, a form of a personality disorder, which tends to be a real heavy-duty psychiatric diagnosis. And now you're throwing red meat at it over and over and over again. So I think, and that's what you're seeing now.
So you just used the example of 19-year-old. You could put 19, you could put 23, you could put 27, whatever. I got some videos here that you and I are going to go over where the age is higher than that. But if we roll it back a little bit, Doc, a person who's 19, who is regurgitating and repeating and sensationalizing what they heard on CNN or MSNBC in what you just talked about, whether it's the Liz Cheney comment or dictator for a day or whatever else it is he said, those statements are being purposely misinterpreted from the hosts that I would say the average age is probably 50 years old on MSNBC and the New York Times and CNN. Do those people too have some sort of disorder? The fact that they so easily can look into a camera and lie when they know that they are sensationalizing things? I mean, yeah. Are they too part of the problem? Not that they're spreading the lie, but that they themselves are believing this.
Well, I think that's the question, right? I think there's a percentage of those hosts who have drank the Kool-Aid and have also been brainwashed, who they're true believers, right? They're spreading what they believe. And I think the more insidious ones are the ones who know that it's BS and that they're purposely manipulating their audience just to get the desired effect. They're purposely throwing the red meat to their vulnerable masses because I think they know that. And I don't know, you know, some of them you could tell are pretty obviously kind of get it. And some of them are just doing it as the old Goebbels, you know, propaganda manipulation, that this is a way to manipulate our masses. But it's happening to such a severe degree. Look, I don't know if last time that we spoke, you know, I did we talk about the young man that I was a witness in the capital murder case in Florida? Did we talk about that young man?
We did, but feel free to repeat it again, man.
Well, because it's an example of how a vulnerable teenager can be so ideologically brainwashed by digital media that they can commit the worst of crimes. Because if you get somebody believing an ideology enough, you know, that's what brainwashing is all about.
Tell the story.
Yeah, the young man's name was Corey Johnson. And he was a Palm Beach County suburban teen who, right middle COVID, so I'm thinking like 2020-21, when he was 16, 17, he was a YouTuber, a politically interested YouTube kid who was alienated and bullied. He looked like a normal kid, suburban Palm Beach County, white adolescent. And he would watch political content on YouTube 24/7. He started as a progressive liberal. And what was really interesting about his case was he began to wear a couple of different identities over the course of about 6 to 12 months, because he shifted from progressive liberal to then he happened to watch a short video clip about the Holocaust. And because he watched that, he started getting the algorithm started sending him Holocaust denying videos and white supremacy videos. And then he became a white supremacist. And so that was his identity, all in on white supremacy. But at a certain point, he started thinking that they were not walking the walk, that a lot of them were hypocritical. And then he happened to watch a short video about Syria and Assad. And then because he watched that, he started getting bombarded by ISIS propaganda content. And within 2 to 3 months, he converted to Islam. He became an ISIS warrior. He was all in. So now think about it. A 16-year-old kid, by the time he became 17, went from progressive liberal, white supremacist. Now he's an ISIS warrior. And this is a kid without underlying mental health issues. He was a vulnerable kid. I'm not going to say that he was, but he didn't have a clear sense of identity. He was like most young adolescent guys today. He had no meaning in his life, no identity, a little bit bullied in school. And now he's all in on ISIS. And ISIS starts sending him. I mean, and ISIS was very sophisticated in the media manipulation, as I would say some of our mainstream media is. So now he starts drinking the Kool-Aid of ISIS. ISIS is a wonderful organization that helps their communities. It was a team that became attractive for him to join. Then after he joined, they started sending him decapitation videos. Now they're desensitizing him. Now they're making it. And when I asked him, because I testified in his capital murder trial, when I asked him, because he, by all accounts, he had been a sweet, sensitive kid, you know, the stereotypical would never hurt a fly. How was it the first time that you saw a decapitation video? These are horrifically graphic videos. He said, I almost vomited. It was terrible. But by the time I saw the 10th video, I was getting, you know, toughened up, because he viewed it as a form of, like, he said it was like me going to Paris Island in boot camp. I thought it was me becoming tougher. And so by the time he had committed these crimes that he committed, which I'll mention in a moment, he had seen over 1,000 decapitations of ISIS content where they kept sending him to him through these videos. So eventually he's so brainwashed, he essentially decapitates a 13-year-old boy alive while he's fighting and struggling and trying to save his life. And he tried to kill 3 other people, including a woman, his neighbor, that essentially was his second mother that had raised him. He stabbed her almost 40 times, almost killed her. It was one of the most horrific crime scenes imaginable. And this was a kid who essentially had fallen down this mental illness rabbit hole of indoctrination and a true believer in these causes just by digital media manipulation. So that's an extreme case. And I think what we're seeing are let's call them milder cases of these kinds of indoctrinating belief systems. Dictator for a day, Hitler, because at the end of the day, Dennis, if you and I really believed, you know, what's the old thing? If you could go back in time and kill Hitler as a baby, where did you kill Hitler to save the world? That's the mindset some of these folks are getting into. If this is an existential threat against humanity, and a lot of these kids want to feel a sense of meaning and purpose, and this is their cause now, their cause has been, they've oversimplified things in black and white terms, Trump bad, Hitler evil, you know, dictator for a day, same drumbeat over and over again. So now they've bought in. And now, of course, they're going to be reacting because now we've just put Hitler in power. So, of course, they're going to react in these intense and crazy ways. But as you said, the fault lies in the brainwashers, the people who knew better and were using this to manipulate their audience.
You know, I get asked this question all the time. I'd be interested to hear what your professional opinion is on it. So I got this thing once a week, Doc. It's Ask DML. It's an episode that we do. And so people can send in questions, whatever. And one of the questions I get all the time is, who do you blame the most in the mainstream media for indoctrinating these people? And I said, I don't blame any of them. I think they're the sugar on top. I blame the schools because I think this stuff starts early. I mean, so I don't have any videos for you today, but there was one video that was circling around X where a woman, a teacher, was recorded in the classroom telling her students how bad Trump is, how bad Republicans are. And so if I connect the dots looking backward, which is the only way you could really do it, I look back and I see school being heavily left. The teachers are heavily left. And nowadays, teachers are basically allowed to do almost anything they want. Parents can't even walk their kids into school anymore. And so it starts in the school system. Then if they go to college, it only gets, you know, exaggerated and exemplified. And then now you've got this 21-year-old who has been forever indoctrinated to be a leftist social media warrior. Right. And now all of a sudden they get the famous people on television, Joe Scarborough, Anderson Cooper, whoever it is, championing the fact that Trump and Republicans are haters, killers, racists, and the world's going to come to an end. And this is where they carry it out on social media, which allows that sort of thing to go. Because as you just said, and I know all too well, the algorithm is based on the more outrageous, the more emotional it could trigger, the more it gets spread. And so I tailor it back to say that it starts in the schools. Do you agree with me or am I going a little bit too far?
No. Unfortunately, you've hit the nail on the head and I've had some interesting first case. Well, first of all, my kids who are finishing up high school and they were telling me this year they were getting it in their classes. I mean, teachers overtly politicizing, criticizing Trump, saying things that, you know, they're supposed to be that neutrality in schools, you know, they're not supposed to be politically biased, but that's, and they go to a nice private school, but they were getting it. But even more so, you're right. So they're getting an elementary school and, you know, things like critical race theory, and this has been debated a lot. And, you know, I talk a lot about pendulum shifts, right? It's the overcorrection that kills us, right? There's the overcorrections. Now, the critical race theory started in the legal world, and it was a way to understand the whole intersectionality belief system is that understanding, and from a legal context, it was a few people in the legal world said, when we're looking at a case, we have to appreciate what were called the intersectional, let's call it identity politics dynamics. So there were different dynamics involved. If you were a black, a female, if you were of a certain ethnic group, gender, what have you. So we should be somewhat sensitized in the legal context how these might have impacted this case. But then the pendulum shifted so far that it became what became known as racial essentialism or reductionism, where everything got seen through the lens of race. Rather than being sensitized to, okay, sometimes in legal situations, race is a factor and things like that can be a factor, it became the ideology that swallowed up the world in the same way that gender ideology has swallowed up the world. It went from being sensitized to certain things around gender to now it's become the dogma, it's become the religion. But back to your point about the schools as indoctrination factories. So, you know, I'm a university professor and I had been one for 7 or 8 years 10 years ago, took a break to open up my treatment programs, and I moved to Austin. I opened up these treatment programs, and I'm back now teaching again for the last couple of years. And in that break, I had about an 8-year break between, and I'm teaching graduate students at a university here in New York. And the change that I've seen in both, not just the content of what we're teaching, but the students. The students were now much more emotionally reactive. I would call them fragile. You know, the stereotypical safe space trigger warning crowd, that happened to me in the blink of an eye. When I was in the classroom over 10 years ago, we were able to have discourse about a variety of challenging topics. And again, these are young, well, not always young, sometimes I have adult students, but these who are graduate mental health students who are supposed to be going to the arena of helping people in mental health. And quite honestly, a lot of them were not that stable. I was teaching a course, Human Behavior. I taught it 10 years ago, and I was teaching it again now. And it used to be everything from Freud to Maslow, Carl Jung, all the dead white guys, right? And now I was told, you're going to teach that same course again. So I know human behavior. I understand the precepts of it. Chapter one was critical race theory, Marxism. And I said, well, wait a second. It was shocking to me how the content had changed. And what you saw that was happening in schools, and every faculty member on the faculty that I teach, every single one, was not just left of center, but extreme left of center. And the one thing that the Maureen Dowd, we talked about before we got on the air, Maureen Dowd wrote an op-ed in the New York Times this morning, and I think she hit the nail on the head. She made the one comment saying that, you know, the faculty lounge became to the extreme left of the minority groups that they were claiming to represent. So things like Latinx and BIPOC and these quote-unquote woke concepts that most mainstream Black, white, and Hispanic aren't down with. My wife is Hispanic, by the way. My wife is Hispanic. And for years, she's been saying, what the hell is this Latinx stuff? And she's an educator, by the way. She's got a master's degree. She's an educated person taught bilingual education. And she said, the Latin, Spanish as a language is gender specific. It's Latina, Latino, to neuter it because some liberal progressive felt that this is the only lens that we should be seeing the world through. She wasn't down with it. Her family wasn't down with it. Her community isn't down with it. But it's the faculty lounge that's down with it. It's the extreme left liberal. And so they're now brainwashing these mental health students that I'm teaching. They're going through these, like you said, ideological echo chambers. I try my best to sort of keep my finger on the scale and sort of create a little perspective as much as is possible within this framework that's very broken, because they've hired like-minded. You know, how I slipped through the cracks, I don't know. I think I did a good job of, I had good professional bona fides. It was hard to deny kind of my credentialing, but it was just interesting because it had shifted so far to the left in just the last 8 years since I'd been in that world, that it was just incredible, to the point where now my kids are going off to college next year. I have twin sons who are looking at colleges, and I don't know if there's a university system out there that's not indoctrinating students in the ways that I'm not comfortable with.
I'm listening to you talk about your two sons, and the first time I ever met you, I met your two sons. I interviewed you. Right. It was back after Parkland, and you were staying at a friend's house, and you were out for the day with your kids and your wife. Right. And I remember them being little boys, and now you're talking about them looking at colleges. We're getting old.
That's right.
We are getting old, man. Right? We are getting old. I'm sitting, wait a second. Is he married to somebody else? I'm like, no. Then you said twins. And I said, well, yeah, I met them.
Same twins. You met them. Yep.
Dude, we're getting old. We're getting old. So it's, you know, when you talk about this indoctrination stuff and about how it is, you know, your wife is Latino, or Latina, and how she's insulted by it in a way. Like, why do we need Latinx? That doesn't make a lot of sense.
Right.
You know, there was a recent poll that said that 85% of Americans, this was a Gallup poll, so you know it's not some BS poll, 85% of Americans support voter ID. And yet, every time that you bring up voter ID, there are people who are going to tell you that that's racist.
Right.
And to me, what that is, if I'm black or if I'm Latino, I'm livid, because what you're right. basically saying is I'm not smart enough to go get myself an ID.
Right.
You know, exactly. don't say it's poverty, because then the Republicans will come back and say, no, we'll make it for free. It's free. And no, it's racist. You just don't want people to vote. I mean, why don't they just come out and say that we don't think they're smart enough to go out and get an ID? And I think after a while, I think these people have picked up on it, that the real party of racism isn't with the party that they're blaming it to be. It's really on the other side, who thinks that, hey, you need help because you can't figure out how to get out of your troubles without me, which is very racist in of itself.
Because that crowd that's espousing that, they're so out of touch. It's their own inherent racism that they're projecting outwards. And it's like you said, that's so condescending to think that a whole group of people aren't capable of getting an ID. And that's the narrative that we've been sold. But, you know, I had a conversation with one of the, in the faculty lounge with one of the professors that I teach with, and she was upset right after the election. And I said, you know, and again, I'm walking on that, you know, I'm trying not to throw fire, you know, Molotov cocktails in there. I'm just trying to, and I just said to her, and she was lamenting, she was white female, you know, in her 40s maybe. And she was lamenting.
Most dangerous of all, Nick. Those are the most dangerous of all.
Yep. And she was lamenting the poor, you know, the Hispanic community, the black community. And I said, well, have you ever stopped to ask yourself why in this last election there was such a spike in the Hispanic vote and then the black vote, why there was such a spike towards, if this person is so bad for those communities, why have they voted for him in record numbers? Have you ever stopped to ask yourself that? And, you know, she had a moment of self-reflection and she said, you know, I did speak to my hairdresser who happens to be black, and she did say something to the effect of, you know, he's good for their daily lives or something about their economy or something to that effect. But it was like, it came as like a thunderbolt of, you know, she was so locked into her belief systems. And again, they've created a narrative that they're the do-gooders, that they're the ones who are going to, you know, I mean, they call it in the movies, they call it like, you know, like the white heroes syndrome, you know, as if these poor impoverished minorities need the white savior syndrome, right? Like, you know, they used to criticize these movies where it was always a white savior had to come in to save the day. And that's, I think, what a lot of these academic types and a lot of these white liberals feel, that they have to sort of save the unwashed masses from themselves. You know, they don't know better. They don't know how to get voter ID cards, and how foolish are they to vote against their own self-interest? Certainly they've been brainwashed by Trump's ideology. So these Hispanics have voted against their own self-interest, because don't they know that Hitler is against them, that he's going to separate Abuela from the grandchild? And so in their own minds, they think they're doing the right thing. They think this is some noble cause. They're in, you know, riding their white horse to save the masses. And it's just such BS. And then when they saw that the people that they're supposed to be representing voted in the opposite way, it just rocked the world upside down. They think now pulled the rug out from under them. They don't know what to make of it.
So in the case of the person who thinks that they're doing something good for the Latino or for the black, you call it, you know, the white hero syndrome, whatever. I mean, what would be the actual clinical definition of that person? Because there's an illness there, is it not?
Well, I mean, you know, so in the mental health world, you know, depression, anxiety, or mood disorders, and then we have personality disorders, and then we have, you know, I think these kind of go more along the line of what are called personality disorders, which would be like histrionic or narcissistic personality disorder. The mental illness that's there, I think, is more, as I mentioned before, you have folks who are not primed for like just emotional reactivity. The mental illness that's there, and that's typically called borderline personality disorder. And the borderline person lives, again, they could only see things in black and white. They tend to simplify things down to their polarities. They don't see the nuance or the spectrum in between two issues, and highly emotionally reactive in between, to the point of hysterics, you know. So And I have a treatment program in Austin, Texas, where we treat young adults who are struggling with a variety of issues. And invariably, you know, the 18 to 30 year olds who have been raised on social media, they can't see things in black and white. So if you say, you know, we're having chicken for lunch today, you don't love me because we're having chicken for lunch today. And of course, they'll have a nuclear meltdown because somehow it gets interpreted in this somehow extreme assault on their own identity. And so there's just this fragility. There's just this reactivity that's not normal. It's not healthy. But we're seeing that more and more, that this is what this is the generational stuff that we've raised. We've raised people who don't have resilience, critical thinking, the ability to sort of rationally look at a situation and do some analysis. Like, again, the dictator for a day, all it would take with 30 seconds of researching, look at the actual quote, see the context, and then it would neutralize it. But instead, because for people who are borderline, the drug of choice is drama. So emotional drama is what feeds their disorder. So anything that makes them more emotionally overreacting, that's the allure, you know, so they seek that out.
Okay. So I'm glad you answered the way you did, because I want to play the first of a few videos here and get your, cause we've got about 20 minutes left. I want to get your reaction to these videos. Okay.
Sure.
This girl, and for people who are only listening, this girl looks like she's either African-American or dark-skinned Latino, and she is probably in her early 20s. She's got two earrings in her nose, one on one side. Her fingers are all tattooed, and she has made a video where it says at the top, she put it there, Trump won. She's got two hearts that are broken, and she has filmed herself just crying. I want you to take a look at this, doctor, okay? It lasts for 15 seconds.
I don't relate to you. I don't relate to you, no. Cause I never treat me this shitty. You made me hate this shit.
So let's take those parts there. She said, I don't relate to you. That's the song that's being played in the background. And she is literally just doing nothing but crying into the camera with Trump one at the top. Now, this isn't somebody who filmed her. She had to set that whole thing up herself.
That took just going to say that.
Took a lot of work, Doc, she took a lot of work in making that video.
Right.
I don't know what legally you can and cannot do, so I'm not asking you to diagnose her. Somebody like her who did the same thing, or if I did the same thing, how would you diagnose me if I did that same thing? What is wrong there?
Right. All right. So it goes back to kind of what I was saying earlier, where we're creating sort of not only emotional reactivity, but, you know, and I'll go back because I've talked about this before a lot, the social media contagion effect. And it has spread mental unwellness in the sense of, all right, when we create our value systems growing up, right, typically our values are baked into us by, you know, family, community, sometimes faith if you're faith-based, but, you know, you have a set of values. What are the values of a young person like her that have been raised in this world of influencers and social media, right? You have views and likes, and attention is one of the highest values. So a lot of the unwell influencers that I've seen, there's a real performative aspect to it. Right. Because like you said so accurately, it took some time and effort for her. She wasn't just in a dark corner crying and sobbing because she was having a genuine emotional situation. She filmed it. She posted it. She had some context. She had some wording around it. This was a performance. I mean, and I don't doubt that she was unstable about the event. But then she, because in her value system, your distress, your emotional reactivity is needs to be now the validation that she needs to get by being performative about it gives her a sense of validation and community. So for so many of our unstable young people, there's a performative aspect to what they do. They have to highlight their distress. I mean, if back in the day, if you and I were depressed, last thing we were going to do was go up on the rooftop and shine the spotlight on ourselves. We were going to kind of, you know, there was a little bit of shame around it. We used to kind of, you know, like we weren't exactly proud of our losing our emotional selves. If our moms died or if something really happened that really upset who we were, who weren't shouting it from the rooftops, but this is the value system that she's been raised on. So she's not stable. She's not well. She reacts in a way that's hyper-emotional, whether it's borderline or histrionic or whatever it may be. And yet the need is to let me air that to the world because that validates my identity around this or my belief around this. I'm going to find tribalism around this. And then there's then what happens is let's outdo each other. So her crocodile tears might have to be now outdone by the next video's crocodile tears. And it's an extremification loop because now it has to be more and more and increasingly high octane for it to have the same impact. And it's a really sick way to go.
What's her, in the most shortest way, what's her chicken soup, man? How do we fix somebody like that?
Well, what her chicken soup should be would be unplugging from the digital toxin that's shaping her sense of identity so corrosively, reconnecting with some face-to-face friends, getting some hobbies in her life that would give her some balance, reading a book, just doing the things that we used to think were the balancing in our lives, because for a lot of the folks like that, I don't know about her specifically, they tend to have no balance in their lives and it tends to be so out of whack towards digital media and the same stuff over and over again. So it would be that, and it would be probably taking or learning about how to critically think, how to have some grit and resilience. And there are ways to do that, right? I mean, when you play sports, you have to learn how to persevere. When you analyze something in a way, when you learn critical thinking skills, you look at things in a nuanced way. So, but first and foremost, you have to lower the intensity of the mental illness. You know, there's an old saying in the mental health world, you can't paint a house that's on fire. First and foremost, you have to put out the fire, and then you could work on building the foundation back up and painting the walls and all the things around the edges. For a lot of our young people, we have to take a fire hose and put out the fire. And putting out the fire means taking away some of this toxic content that keeps brainwashing these kids.
You know, I don't know what country it is. Man, I wish I could remember. It's not coming to my mind. It may actually be New Zealand. I could have it wrong. They just passed a law that 16 or younger can no longer have social media of any kind, not even with parental consent.
A lot of countries are looking at that initiative. They're looking at it as this is an addictive, so it's brain altering and mind shaping. I like to say brain altering and mind shaping. So these are addictive platforms, but they're not just addictive like Pringle potato chips are addictive. They're also shaping the way you perceive the world and the way you think. So they're addicting and mind shaping. And so a lot of countries are, France is looking at those initiatives, your state of Florida. I testified in front of your state legislature about a year and a half ago to get social media out of all schools, K-12. Governor DeSantis passed that into a law. That bill was passed into a law about a year and a half ago. So a lot of people are waking up to the fact that there should be age restraints, because we hadn't realized that how impactful some of these platforms are to vulnerable kids. But like you said, it's also the classroom now. So you could take the social media away, but now if you have the teachers who have been brainwashed and they're slipping it in the back door.
Let me toss another one up here. This is a young girl, white girl this time. Looks like she's again somewhere 20 years old, maybe a few years older, maybe even a little younger. And because we're running out of time, I'll skip one of the other videos. There was a video going around, the 4D, I'm not sure what the D stood for, but, or the 4Ds, but it was that women were no longer going to have sex now that Trump won. They were basically going to keep themselves because from having sex. So this way they couldn't get pregnant and Trump couldn't ban them from having an abortion. This girl goes the totally opposite route. And she goes in a different way to where she's going to now try to have sex with conservative men and change them. Let me play this video for you.
If you're a conservative woman, here's how I'm going to fix your life, okay? So you just got married to your husband. Your husband is blatant, just redneck garbage. You like him, though. For some reason, something there is clicking. I'm going to seduce your husband. I'm going to look him in the eye. And I'm going to explain to him that nobody has ever made me feel the way he has. And I'm younger than you conservative woman that married him.
and I'm gonna start like explaining that I'm just so fun and I like doing fun shit, because you're probably married and you can't do fun shit. And then once I do that and I implement your fucking marriage arc, he's gonna cause some irrational feelings, which is going to establish itself in your marriage problems. And then you're gonna be like, why am I doing this shit for a man? This is where we get ya, because then you're like, why am I supporting a guy that isn't doing anything for me? There you go.
So, Doc, you know, you've done a lot of TV. I've done a majority of my adult life has been on TV. I have said things before on live TV that I wish I could have taken back. Not horrible things, but, you know, I may have said, yeah, you know what? When I look at the 500 states of the United States of America, blah, blah, and I'm like, 500? My God, I meant to say 500 people who died in 50 states. You say the wrong thing. You can't go back. People know basically what you meant to say. You just said it wrong. I mean, I'll give you an example, perfect example. The other day, Fox News during the election, I think it was Dana Perino or somebody said, we scanned 120 people, and this is what they say. And really, it was 120,000. Brett Baer went and corrected her. But you're in the heat of the moment. It's live TV. Nothing kicks. In this particular case, as an editor, I can see what she did is she actually edited that video. So she made it shorter. She made it more compact. She wanted to make sure she got her best highlights. Any ums, you likes, you knows, she pulled it out. My point saying is that if you are on live and you say something that you wish you didn't say, but you let it go because it's, you know, you can't get it back, that's one thing. But when you record yourself and then you get to see yourself saying what you're saying, you're actually doing it for a second time. And then maybe even a third and fourth time after the edits are done, you watch it back, you got to upload it, you see it. This girl saw what she was saying multiple times and still felt as if it was okay to post. She had chances to walk back her mistake and she didn't do it. So question here is multifaceted. Number one, what does it say about a person, almost like the same as the girl in the last video, who multiply sees herself multiple times and just every time she sees it doesn't find it, I sound like an idiot, and she's still going to go. And then number two is, what does it say about a young girl like that who now has a goal of sleeping around with strangers and guys who she considers to be rednecks, and then lastly, doing it so this way she destroys a marriage? I mean, to me, that's one of the most scary people there are out there.
Yeah, I mean, I have to think, and I don't know, that it falls under kind of projective fantasy. I mean, I think she's like putting it out there that, I mean, if this young woman were to actually go door to door trying to find quote unquote rednecks to seduce, it sounds more like she's posting what she's having now is a fantasy, that this is going to be her way of like fighting back, because I find it hard to believe that she would actually put this plan into action. But again, going back to the social media world being what it is, I think she found that it would be a provocative fantasy for her to post, because it's, you know, she's part of the resistance now. Now people are finding it, let me come up with a different thing to post that I could virtue signal that I'm part of this resistance against, you know, the new Hitler that's been put in, and her, she's going to be Mata Hari, right? She's going to be seducing the new, enemy soldiers. You know, it's nonsense. It's fantasy. It's delusional.
You talked about when we were kids, like if you and I, right, you used the example of your mother died or anything emotional happened to you, you got cut from the football team or whatever it may be, you hid your emotions, you kept it back, you didn't want anybody calling you a pussy, or, you know, back in that day, we used to call it faggot, right? It used to be like, ah, you're a faggot if you cried, right? God forbid you use that word anymore in that context. In this particular, when young girls were our age, back when we were in school, they didn't want anybody to know they were sleeping around because they'd be called a slut. She doesn't even care. Is it? I mean, there's no sensitivity at all. I mean, it's almost as if she doesn't care if people say she's a slut. I mean,
it goes beyond that caring. It becomes like that becomes a higher value. I mean, the value to be seen on social media and her, she's willing to sacrifice being promiscuous for the greater cause, you know? And again, whether it's a fantasy or whether she's got a plan to go to, you know, her next door neighbors and seduce them, either way, it's crazy.
I go to the next level of crazy, which this goes to the highest of levels. And this is where my concern is. A lot of these people that we're watching here today go to this level. I don't have a video for this. I'll just throw up the picture of the family. But Anthony, nephew is his name, 45 years old, killed himself, his wife, and two sons over Trump winning. Now, is that
I read about that yesterday, right? That was the one that just recently happened. What state was that in?
I don't know the state. I don't know. I don't know the state, but I mean, to me, and I'm not certified as a doctor or anything in that case. In fact, some people would say I'm certifiably crazy myself, but I think that this guy was looking to probably kill himself prior and just use this as an example. I mean, or an excuse. And I mean, how sick is somebody that they're going to kill off their entire family, not just themselves, Doc, because somebody won an election?
You know, so the Medea complex or the Medea case used to be when mothers would kill their children, like the classical Medea had done, in an effort to save them, right? It's again, it goes back to like a misguided savior complex. So yeah, this man, anybody who commits suicide or homicide is mentally disturbed. But I think the ideology or the mindset behind it, when you take out your family like that, so when you read sometimes about, you know, so of course there's postpartum depression and you have mothers who have killed their children, but there have been cases which are called Medea cases where the mothers are going to save their kids from a evil husband or a messed up world or whatever it is, but it's kind of a savior complex again. This dad sounds to me like he thinks the world's been taken over by Hitler. You know, probably some of the brainwashing that we've talked about. And this was his misguided, homicidal, insane effort to save them. He's going to take himself out and save his children by taking them out. And that is Medea-ish, because that's you're going to kill your children to rescue them from a intolerable world or whatever the reality that you perceive is. That's the definition of insanity. So,
all right, so then let me give you another one here. I don't know. I don't know if this woman is actually doing this for the playing up to the cameras. Maybe she is. I want your expert opinion on this one. But this woman here, for people who are not watching and just listening, this is a blonde woman. She looks like she's in her 30s, maybe late 30s. From some of the things I can see on the shelves before it gets to her, she looks like she's a mom. I'll just play a few couple of seconds of this.
It's all right. It's all right. I feel that way too. It's all right. We feel that way together, okay? Let it out. Let it out.
I mean, Nick, that's extreme, man. I mean, if that's an actress, I don't know. She just looks extreme.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and it, again, it's look how extremely unstable these folks are acting. And then look at the need to have to then post it, to then get views and likes out of it. That's the part that's really, again, if they really thought this was Hitler, okay, you want to die in a cry in a dark corner, but to be then posting it, there's just something even doubly wrong about that. You're not only having a brainwashed, overly emotional reaction to something, you're not only showing your instability, but yet now you're making it aspirational to be unstable, and you're trying to find community with other unstable people. And that is part of it too, right? People who are unstable like to find community. So now let us all come together in our instability. And then that has an amplification effect too, right? You find another 10 people screaming and crying about the election. So now you're finding community that amplifies and it validates your extreme ideology. So in that sense, it makes sense, kind of. But it's not well.
You know, you also got people like Barbara Streisand and all these other celebrities saying that they're going to leave the country if Trump wins. And then Trump wins and they don't leave the country.
Yeah.
Is that a form of mental illness as well?
It's a form of narcissism. You know, again, it goes back to the celebrity thing, like the world, we're going to tell you how to vote. I look at like the Robert De Niro of the world, like his kind of extreme emotional, I mean, like venom and the anger. And you know, Dennis, the one thing that I've kind of really come to see things, I read an analysis about the election, the 2016 election, the Clinton-Trump election. And I thought it was really spot on. It said, you know, all roads lead back to our own high school shaping experiences, right? And there are archetypes in high school, right? There's the jock, the bully, the, you know, think about the Breakfast Club, right? And all the different characters that were there. And those are kind of hardwired into us. And it said that this analysis, this political analysis said, Hillary Clinton represented the nerdy girl who knew all the answers and sat in the front and everybody kind of like resented because she was the smarty pants. Trump was the alpha male jock that people kind of like disliked, like wanted to be his friend because they didn't want to get on this bad side. And look, at the end of the day, Trump represents a certain archetype. He represents something. He's the alpha male, rough edged, whatever he, you know, we can say about him, but he represents a certain archetype. And then, so to me, when I see, you know, there's an old saying in the mental health field, when you're doing group therapy or group work, when somebody has an extreme, unusual emotional reaction to something that doesn't seem proportionate to the situation, there's, we call it a transference is happening. Something's being kicked up, some projection, something from that person's childhood is being brought up. So, you know, in like the De Niro world or the Barbara Streisand, Donald Trump represents that guy who might have kicked sand in De Niro's face when he, because let's face it, De Niro's a wannabe tough guy, right? De Niro's a wannabe tough guy who's played, you know, all these roles his whole life. And yet Trump represents something to him that really hits a nerve. Trump represents something with some of these, you know, I'm carefully using the word beta males or you know, more, or some of these women. He represents something, and that's what's kicking up all these feelings. It's the guy in high school that, you know, and I heard, by the way, like in the movie, like Back to the Future, the creator of Back to the Future, the character of Biff in that movie was based on Donald Trump. This is like, you know, 1980s Donald Trump. This is real estate mogul Donald Trump, because he represented this kind of like brash, bullying kind of archetype, and a lot of people can't handle that. And the fact that this person is now quote unquote winning really, really triggers people in ways that we are seeing are so disproportionate to the reality. Because the reality of his first 4 years of president, there were no internment camps, there was no authoritarianism. Black colleges were funded for 10 years in ways that never were. He did some of the largest criminal justice reform that benefited Black people than any other president before, including Barack Obama. And all those things that he's done get totally discounted and not mentioned in the pursuit of the emotional attacks against, you know, the new Hitler. And so it's we have to see it for what it is. You know, we have to be the ones that see with clarity of mind what's really going on, because there's a lot of emotional craziness out there right now.
And that's the, you know, there's the other thing too. I won't play the clip because I know we're short on time. We've got to end this up. But there's a guy on MSNBC. He's one of the regular, I don't know who it is, he's a regular guest. And he will not accept the fact that Trump won the election because people have been tired of inflation, open borders, and funding Ukraine. In his mind, we have 75 million people who are inherently racist, can't accept a woman of color being in power, and anybody who says to the different is an absolute racist and denier. And you just sit there and you want to say to them, wait a second, why are you ignoring that Barack Obama was the president twice?
Right.
Why are you ignoring the fact that people in the Republican Party voted for Ben Carson? He was the number two guy the entire time in 2016. Why do you ignore that? Why do you think the people of color who, or even white people, do the same thing? Why are they so apt to choose racism as being the example when voters are asked point blank, why did you vote for Trump and not Harris? And on top of that, as you just explained, we've got Blacks and Latinos who voted for Trump in huge numbers. What's the denial part there? Is there something mentally ill with them as well?
Well, it's their own projection too. Obviously, they see the world in racial terms, and so they're projecting that on the whole country. And so obviously, if they're seeing things through the racial lens, but that goes back to the overcorrection of critical race theory and intersectionality. You know, if we're not going to do the Martin Luther King thing and look at people through the content of their character if we're going to look at people as only their melanin, amount of melanin that they have, and reduce people down to ethnicity, race, religion, gender, orientation, because we were supposed to be sensitized to those things, but we weren't supposed to, it wasn't supposed to swallow up the world. So he's now been living his life for the last 10, 15 years of, it's all about race. Not that race is a component of the realities of the world that we live in, but that it's all about that. It's all self-defining because it is in his worldview. So now he projects his worldview on everyone. So it can't be that the 74 million people that voted for Donald Trump voted for on policy or voted on other issues. It has to be. And it can't be that they rejected Kamala Harris because maybe she wasn't a great candidate. Maybe they don't think she'd be a great president. It has to be because it was a racial element.
It's funny when you say that, because in that video clip, the black guy says to the white woman who's the host, he says, look, I love you. He's like, but you won't come to terms with it because you can't come to terms with it. So in other words, she is looking at this from a policy and a financial situation, and he's saying it's a denial because she can't come to terms with the truth is that America doesn't want to have a Latino or black or an Indian in office, which is just absolutely bizarre. I only got you 2 more minutes. Let me ask you 2 quick questions, and then because I'd be curious to see what you say about these 2 things. Number one, from the standpoint of Kamala Harris, she was hiding. She wouldn't give interviews. And then when she did get in to give interviews, she couldn't get out a cognizant sentence. She would just, it's like me asking you what you had for breakfast, and you start going into conversation about the first car you ever bought. And I'm wondering, did you see something there in Kamala Harris mentally that said to you, she isn't firing on all cylinders?
Well, I mean, you know, I've got to be careful here too. I mean, A, she's no Barack Obama in the sense of her ability to be an orator or her locution. So, you know, I mean, I don't call it mental illness. She just seemed to be more scattered in her thinking. You know, she didn't have to have clarity of mind. I will say, you know, I'm also an addiction psychologist. There were times that I thought that she was under the influence. There were times that it felt like her words were slurring, and it felt like she had been, she had bent the elbow a little bit and maybe was, because it was clear there were there was a handful of interviews that I'd seen that she seemed slurred. So, you know, I just don't think she was the ideal candidate. And again, we know that she was put in because of intersectional dynamics. Joe Biden said, I'm going to pick a black woman, not the best candidate. And look, do I think that there's some voters out there who probably don't want a woman or a black person in to hold the highest office in the land? Of course there are people out there who probably that is their agenda. But as you said, most of us were able to vote for a Barack Obama. The country has shown that we've moved a long way past, I think, some of the racial, the segregation and the racial policies that we're kind of going backwards. You know, Bill Maher is being criticized a lot for saying this, that we've made racial progress, and yet the new batch of racial agitators, of people that want to see things just through the racial lens, want to deny the progress that we've made. We can acknowledge that things are still imperfect by also saying we've made a lot of progress because we've had a black president for 2 terms. Didn't cure us of all our racial ills, but to say that everything is around race is just so simplistically childish. It's so reductionist, and it doesn't make any sense on a practical level. So the denial is you can't acknowledge that your candidate might have been a flawed candidate. That can't be the reality. Or the policies on the other side were more attractive. That can't possibly be an option. You're so myopically focused on race that you can't see those two as possible alternatives.
It's crazy. This has nothing to do with the politics. This has to just do with behavior. And again, give me the shortest or longest answer. It's up to you. But recently, the New York Yankees unfortunately lost to the LA Dodgers. And when the Dodgers won the World Series, the first reaction from a lot of African Americans in LA was to burn down and destroy stores. And I'm trying to understand the behavior there. What triggers that? Because I thought that there was going to be a lot of that sort of thing when Trump won the election. And there wasn't, thankfully. That what we're seeing more is white women buzzing their hair off and saying they're going to go sleep with strangers and people who won't give up on the idea that the country isn't racist. What's triggering these inner city kids to burn down their own cities when something like my team just won? What drives that?
You know, it's kind of, you know, I think there's just, it becomes almost like, I think, an excuse to kind of, if there's pent up rage and if there's pent up frustration, get an event like the World Series, it becomes almost kind of a literally a get out of jail free card, because, you know, I don't know how many folks got actually arrested for that. But I think it's an opportunity to kind of vent, you know, whatever, whether it's justified or unjustified, it's like, it's an opportunity to, and then you go into sort of that mob mentality where now if everyone else is doing it, you're going to kind of fall into place because everyone else is having this sort of episode. But to your point, interestingly, it didn't happen from an election standpoint. And I find that kind of curious, because you would have thought we would have seen George Floyd-like riots as a result of this election, but we didn't. And I think that's even a more interesting analysis. And it has been because more Hispanic and Black males were supportive of this presidency, and the rage was coming from the faculty lounge more so. And the faculty lounge crowd is not known to, you know, turn cars over.
No. Yeah. So let me ask you this. If people want to follow you, if they want to, you know, check out your books and stuff of that nature, where do they find you, Doc?
Yeah, my books are on Amazon. Glow Kids and Digital Madness are on Amazon. My website is drkardaris.com is my website. And I run the treatment program in Austin called Omega Recovery, which is omegarecovery.org, where we help young people who are struggling with mental health issues, with digital media issues, with substance issues as well. And I want to thank you for having me on, for the work that you're doing, because these are strange times we live in.
They are strange times. In fact, I want to have you, because we're short. I have no more time left, but I want to, because they're going to turn off the recording here. But with all that's happening with AI and the push for social media and the fighting between X and Facebook and everything else that's going on, I think we may be in a situation where things are going to get worse than they already are here. I'd like to have you back in a couple of weeks, if it's okay with you. We'll go with the timing and have you back, where we're going to talk about AI and the impact it's going to have on our youth.
It's not going to make things better. That's the short version, but I'd love to be back on. Sure. Dennis, thank you.
All right. Dr. Nick, my friend, great to see you. And man, we're getting older. Your kids are going to be going to college soon. That's just crazy. All right, bud. Thanks so much.
Thanks, Dennis.
All right, that's it for me. I want to say thank you, Dr. Nick Cardaris. Great guy, smart guy, gave a lot of insight. Did he not? Yep, he certainly did. Make sure that you go and check him out. Make sure you follow me on X, x.com/trustDML. Also, if you could become a Team DML member, that would be great. You get to watch this show all the time. All the shows, we're producing a lot of new shows, so it can be really, really cool stuff. You could get it, get in there and be a team member. And of course, don't forget team dmlcbd.com/BOGO for our buy one, get one free. That's it for me. God willing, tomorrow, Denny and I and Ryan will be back in the studio with our program, talking about Trump, his new picks, what's going on in the world of getting ready to become the 47th president. A lot of cool stuff. All right. Until then. Till the next time, may God bless you, our troops, Dr. Nick, Donald J. Trump, and all of our Team DML members. We'll talk to you soon.
Get the Dennis Michael Lynch podcast every day by subscribing on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, and download the DML News app from the Google Play Store or the Apple App Store for breaking news, merchandise, films, exclusive content, and Team DML.